Welcome to West End Baptist Church this morning for our monthly family service. And welcome to our visitors that we have with us today. You're very welcome to join us. Welcome to those online too. Not Prayer 19 tonight, because it's now being called the Upper Room, because it is in the Upper Room. Fitted out with chairs and a piano. So that's tonight at 6 o'clock. Walking Westbury will be next Sunday, the 17th of September, at 2:30 p.m. Meet here. Harvest Supper is on Saturday, the 23rd of September, at 6 p.m. here. More details to follow. There will be a joint harvest service with the Bratton and Stormwell Baptist Churches on Sunday, the 24th of September here, and the envelopes for the BMS appeal will be available then. The church family gathering, the church meeting, will be meeting on Thursday, the 28th of September at 7:30 p.m. Please do come along. Offering bags will go round in the second song, and there is also a bake sale for the charity Arosha, an environmental charity, next Sunday. So please bring change, and if anyone would like to bake something for this sale, then please do and bring it along. Ivor would now just like to have a few words with you.
Morning, everyone. Just to say, as you're all aware, that in 2025 we'll be celebrating 200 years on this site, and the committee's been starting to formulate some ideas and get some plans together. One of the things that we do need, though, is a bit of cash. So we thought a fun way to do it was to be through SmartyTube. So what I'd like you to do is I invite you all to go and see Evan after the service, who's got a stock of these, and get a SmartyTube. This can be filled with any coin that's legal that will go in here. So I'm not sort of saying it's all got to be pounds or 20p's or whatever. I'm just saying it can be mixed. So we'd be very grateful if you could fill your Smarty tube and enjoy the Smarties in between. Once the tube is full, if you return it to me, we will give you another one to fill. So if you could fill it with your spare change, so that it will give the committee a little bit of working capital, because we, finances are fairly tight, as you know. So that it was just a fun way of raising a little bit of funds for us to pay for the odd things that we need to pay for. So if you see Evan after the service, he's got them. And you can go on just filling and filling, and every time we'll give you a new tube. Okay, for the time being. Thank you very much.
We will now have the gathering. If you say the text in bold, I will say the rest.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights above.
Praise the Lord.
Praise him, all his angels praise. Praise him, all his heavenly hosts.
Praise the Lord.
Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars.
Praise the Lord.
Praise him, you highest heavens and you waters above the skies.
Praise the Lord.
Praise him, kings of the earth and all nations.
Praise the Lord.
Praise him, young men and women, old men and children.
Praise the Lord.
Let us praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted.
His splendor is above the earth and the heavens. Praise the Lord.
Morning, saints. Let's stand together as we sing our first song together. Now, this is an oldie but a goodie. So the actions are in the chorus. So you've got, you came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth, like a globe. You have to make a globe to the cross, and then you have to make a cross. My debt to pay, so you can just wipe your hand off like that. From the cross to the grave, so you make a mound. From the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. You can make some L's with your hands there. So do you want to try that together, the actions? So you came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lovely. Right, let's give it a go then. Please be seated. I should tell you, you don't stay standing. Although you might want to stay standing and let the air flow, given the heat. Right. Has anyone ever been called a name? As in, like, name calling. Like, somebody shouted across the ray or something. And, you know, I'm pretty sure when I was about 10 or 11, I got glasses for the first time. And Four Eyes was a popular one among people. It wasn't fun. Anybody else got any names they were called?
I was always called
Freckles. Freckles, yeah. Anybody else? Heather?
Ha ha.
Ha ha. Oh, that's not a name call. That's quite nice. It's nice, like a nickname. Ivor the Engine. Yes, yeah. The Engine. Anyone else? Viv? Oh, okay, Roy. So that's a bit. That's not very nice, is it? No. Yes, yeah. The TV show was good. Yeah. Anybody else?
Hopeless.
Oh, that's terrible. Yeah, Margaret.
Straggy Maggie.
That's even worse.
Oh.
Well, there we go. I'll tell you mine a bit later on. That'll get you thinking. What was the thing people used to call me? It's not nice when you get called a name, like a mean name. It's not great, is it? So today we're looking at the time when the first Christians were called Christians. The first believers were called Christians. And you could see it as a bit of a name calling, like a mean name calling thing, but it wasn't really, because it was They call them that because the people in Antioch, they really liked to give people names when they had some sort of political affiliation or they followed a person or something like that. So what you had was, you had people who followed Herod and they called them Herodians and people like that. And so that's what the Antiochs did. They just give people nicknames. That's what they did. And so Christians, or Christianoi in the Greek, if you want to be precise, it means somebody who is a follower or a servant of Jesus or of Christ, because they thought that Christ was his name. And so they thought but I want to clarify this, because I'm not sure we all understand this. The name Christ is not a name. It's a title. Christ means Messiah. It's Jesus' title. So when we say Jesus Christ, other than those who like to use it as a swear word in the world, which I like to challenge people on if I have the gumption. I don't often have the gumption, so got to work on that one. Anyway, people, you say Jesus Christ, you might think that it's to do, that's his name. His first name is Jesus, and his no, it's not. It's his title. So it's actually Jesus the Christ, or Jesus the Messiah. So it's but somebody who's called a Christian is somebody who's supposed to be a follower or servant of the Messiah or the Christ. So we're going to explore the idea of what that means for us and what that name means for us today and what impact it should have. So there we go. We're going to sing again together, and I think Evan's got something to do at the back. We're going to sing, and we'll take up our offering, and we'll pray for it when we've. So visitors, you obviously you don't have to give if you don't want to. This is for those of us who are regular. So let's stand as we're able. Sing of the name of Jesus. All my days I will sing this song.
Beautiful Savior, wonderful kind.
thank you that your name is above all names. We sing the name that is above all names, Jesus. Jesus, name above all names, beautiful Savior, glorious Lord, Emmanuel, God is with us, blessed. Bless your name. We bless the name of the Lord. Redeemer, Emmanuel, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God. We thank you for your name. We thank you that we can be bearers with you in your name. So, Father, take our hearts, take our lives, take this, the gifts that have been given. Bless them and bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Good. Please be seated. We're going to read from the Bible together now, and Guy's going to come and read for us. Thank you, Guy.
Okay. Right. The reading is from Acts chapter 11, and it's verse 19 to 30. Now those who were scattered because of the persecution that took place over Stephen travelled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, and they spoke the word to no one except Jews. But among them were some men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who, on coming to Antioch, spoke to the Hellenists also, proclaiming the Lord Jesus. The hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number became believers and turned to the Lord. News of this came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. When he came and saw the grace of God, he rejoiced, and he exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast devotion. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. And a great many people were brought to the Lord. Then Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. So it was that for an entire year they met with the church and taught a great many people. And it was in Antioch that the disciples were first called Christians. At that time, prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch. One of them, named Agabus, stood up and predicted by the Spirit that there would be a severe famine over all the world, and this took place during the reign of Claudius. The disciples determined that according to their ability, each would send relief to the believers living in Judea. This they did, sending it to the elders by Barnabas and Saul. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Guy. Right. I did a PowerPoint this today just for you. I knew it was going to happen. It's not my friend today, this clip. I don't know why. Three times it's fallen off. Hey, maybe it's my thorn in the flesh like Paul. Never mind. Okay. So we talked about name calling and how it's not a particularly nice experience, particularly if it's a very bad name. You know how some bullies like to pick on your greatest insecurity and they call you a name based on that? It's like they've got a sixth sense that they know how to do that. It's incredible. It's difficult when a name sticks as well. And so forever you're known by that horrible name. But this name, Christians, has actually been with us from the beginning, more or less, which is really interesting. And it stuck. They didn't realize quite how good that name was going to be. So if we go to the next slide, you see that there's a quote here. I don't know if you can see it very well. This is from Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet. Juliet sees Romeo and she thinks, hey, he's a bit nice, isn't he? And then she realizes who he is and that she's not even supposed to be looking at him, let alone talking to him. And she says, what's in a name? That which we call a rose. By any other name would smell as sweet. She seems to be suggesting here that the idea of naming things is irrelevant. What's the point in giving them name? It's pointless. There's no need. I actually have to say I kind of disagree. Names are really important, especially in the Bible. You see, throughout the Bible, names are important. They signify who you are. They give you some of your identity. People know you by your name. And all these kinds of good things come out of having a name. They're not insignificant, and they're important. And if we go to the next one, you might be looking at this and thinking, what on earth is that? And how do you say that? So when I was growing up, I had an adoptive grandfather, because both my granddads died before I was born, so I never knew them. But we used to live on, we had a mobile home, a big long caravan thing, trailer thing, and we used to live on the land of one of the deacons in the church, and he took me under his wing as an adoptive grandson. He was effectively my adopted granddad, and he was very embedded in Louisiana culture, and part of the Native Americans in that area, Choctaw, the Choctaw Indians, as they're known, called the bowfin, which is what this fish is called, they called him a shoepick. The actual name, shoepick, means mudfish. I have to say, when I realized what that was, I really didn't like my nickname. But he used to call me. That used to be what he used to call me. Nobody really ever calls me that name anymore, except for my brother. He's the only one that seems to have adopted that as a nickname. But as I don't talk to him very often, I don't have to worry about being called Shoepick that much. So there we go. That's my nickname. But believers were first called Christians at Antioch as a bit of a nickname. So we go to the next slide. So Antioch, like I said, they must have heard the title. So I don't know how clear that is. Not massively clear. Antioch is near the top. It's not at the end of the red line. It's just around the corner. Tarsus is where it is. I want to just give you a little bit of an idea where Tarsus is. And down at the bottom is Jerusalem. So when they sent Barnabas from Jerusalem to Antioch, it was quite a ways. It was not and even then, from Barnabas to get to Saul in Tarsus, that was another 100-mile journey. So he had to walk all that way. So when it says when it says he went to look for him, it wasn't a mean feat. But Antiochans, they used to call people based on who they followed. And so Christians were called follow Christians. So what's important about why Luke uses this name, Christians, here, is because he's using it to distinguish between Christians who weren't Jews and Christians who weren't who were no longer Gentiles. They were Gentiles, but they weren't like believers, like God-fearers, as Cornelius was called in the previous chapter. So it distinguishes them between everybody. They are completely different. They're not the same as the people around them. They're not the same as the Jews from whence the sect came. They're different. And that's the key in this bit, is what Luke is trying to do here, is show us that the Christians were different. They were distinct. They weren't the same. So if we go to the next slide, if that's the same, people need to look at us and see Jesus. If we bear his name, even though it's his title, if we bear his name, we must look like him in our lives in some way. We can't be the same as the culture around us. And believe you me, the church has lots of stuff in it that mirrors the culture and echoes the culture. Some of it good, some of it not so good. But we've got to look like Jesus because we are his servant. We belong to him. And that's important for us today, because if we want other people to know about Jesus, then they need to see him in us. If we bear his name, our lives have got to show that we look like Jesus. We talk like him. We don't necessarily wear our beards like him. Obviously, that's not what I'm talking about. It's not physical likeness. And for women, that would be quite difficult. Unless you wanted to take some testosterone injections and then maybe you could grow a beard. I don't know. That's entirely up to you. We've got to look like Jesus, not physically, but in our character, our lives. Our character's got to look like Jesus. So the next slide, this is an icon of Barnabas. And I'm going to use Barnabas here to just pick out the three things that Luke tells us about him in this little short passage, to show that Barnabas is a bloke who lives up to his name. Barnabas was not his actual name. I forgot what his actual name was. If you read further back in the earlier chapters, we read it before. But his name, Barnabas, means son of encouragement. That's who he was. He was the son of encouragement. So, three things. First one, and that's on the next slide. Be joyful. Be joyful. This is who Barnabas was. He goes to Antioch, bearing in mind he had a long way to travel, as you saw on the map. It was a really long, long old way. He got there, and far from looking at what God was doing and saying, oh, but these they're not doing this right, they're not doing that. He didn't do any of that. He looked, he saw what was happening, and he said, whoa, and he blessed them. And he said, yeah, carry on, and he encouraged them with words. He wasn't a downer on it, but he says he rejoiced. Barnabas rejoiced. So that tells me that there's something about living up to our name. Christians rejoice. We need to be people who are joyful. We really ought to be, because we have the best hope in the entire universe. We really ought to be the most joyful people on the planet. It doesn't mean we have to be enthusiastic all the time, but it does mean that we should have that deep joy within us. Some of us have that joy really deep down, that it's covered over with God knows what else, and we don't ever see that joy, and they never tell their faces that they have that joy, and we get deadpan and complaining all the time. And that's difficult. We should be, when we see what God is doing, we should be joyful. So if we're going to be a distinct people, if we're going to be different, if we're going to look like Jesus in our characters and live up to the name Christian, we should be joyful. And the second thing, very quickly, be an encourager. Be an encourager. Barnabas looks at what God's doing, he rejoices at God's work, and then he encourages them. And it says he encourages them to remain faithful to God with steadfast devotion. All he says and all that he does is to bring encouragement and to bring comfort and to strengthen them in their faith. He builds them up. He's not condemning. He's not saying, oh, you're doing that wrong. Oh, you shouldn't be doing this. Oh, you shouldn't be doing that. You got to be doing it this way. He doesn't do any of that. He encourages them. He builds them up in their faith. He's not disciplinary. He's not kind of taking I've got a mandate from Jerusalem. He doesn't do any of that. He blesses them and he encourages them with what he wants, what they're doing. And so I don't know if you know people like this. I'm not suggesting it's anybody in the room. But some people like to complain. And I have to talk to myself. You know how when you point the finger, you point three back to yourself? Yeah, this is me, okay, right now. I like to complain a lot about everything and be critical about everything. Preaching. Oh, no, he should have said that. Oh, he missed this point. He should have done that. I don't know. The government. Why aren't they doing this? The road. People driving. Everything. I will criticize and complain about anything. That's not good. Just to say, that's not a good example to follow. Don't follow my example. Follow Barnabas' example. And don't complain about everything. Like, I'm really struggling not to complain about how hot I feel right now. And I know we've all been hot all week, so there's no point complaining because it ain't going to change it. It will cool off eventually, one day, but we just need to cope with, you know, I know we've had a week of it, but we just need to crack on with it. Complaining and criticizing everybody and everything isn't Jesus' way. That's not what we see Jesus doing, except for the Pharisees. And he did take them to task, but the reason he took them to task is because they should have known better, and they didn't, and they didn't believe in who he was. But Barnabas, he didn't do that. He didn't come and complain. He said, well done, guys. I'm going to encourage you. And, you know, so much so that he said, I've got to go and get Saul. I've got to go and get Paul. Paul is the apostle to the Gentiles. I'm going to come and get him to help me with the work. So he leaves them and he goes off and he finds Paul. If we're going to live up to the name Christian, the name of Jesus, and we're going to show people who Jesus is, we need to be people who learn to encourage one another with our words and our lives. So, yes, there will be times when, like Jesus had to talk to the Pharisees in a stern way, there will be times when we have to complain about certain things in our culture. There will be times when we have to take a stand for things, and it might seem negative. But generally, our life should be encouraging. Speaking a word of, oh, don't you look nice today? Do you know how there's some people, it just naturally exudes from them? Like you think of their name and you just think of them and instantly you put a smile on your face because they're just so naturally encouraging. I'm not saying we can all be that way, but we can at least try and make an effort. I know I have to try more and do more of that. It's got to be our way of life to encourage, to strengthen, and to build comfort people in their faith. So if we're going to live up to being Christians, then we've got to learn to be encouraging people in all of our lives. And then the final thing is be good, full of the Spirit, and of faith. This is how Luke described Barnabas. He said he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit, and full of faith. And it must have been that this was his demeanor because people saw it in him, not just from what he said, but this is the way that people recognized this in him. And this really, friends, it's got to be no difference for us. People should be able to be around us for any length of time and say, oh, wow, they're a good person. And feel something of the Spirit upon us, that our life as it connects and intersects with their life, be it ever so short or for a long time, people should recognize these things, that we're good, that they feel the Spirit within us and our faith and respond to our faith in some way. Whatever that may look like. But that only happens if we let the Lord do it within us. And we've got to let God in. As we said last week about the little door of our heart, if we let God into that little door of our heart, what happens? We become good. Jesus makes us good. Jesus gives us the Spirit. He sends us the Spirit. He's given us his Spirit. And when we're full of the Spirit, things change in our lives. And we are full of faith. No longer are we doubting all the time, but we trust in God and we have faith for the future and for our lives. And there will be times when we won't be good. There'll be times when we make mistakes and we mess up and we do it wrong. And there'll be times, but we just need to turn around, change and try not to do it again. And then there'll be times when we might not feel particularly full of the Holy Spirit. But that's why we have to ask every day, Holy Spirit, fill me up because I need you. I can't do this without you. And then there might be times when our faith seems weak and we don't know. We struggle even to understand what God is up to and we don't know what's going on. And other than just asking for faith, we also need to exercise faith. I believe faith is more like a muscle. And you know what happens to muscles when they don't get exercised? Yeah? They atrophy, which means they waste away. They get to nothingness. I saw somebody the other day walking, and their legs were like sticks. I was like, they didn't barely had any muscle on it. It was weird. I was like, how can your leg be that thin? My legs are huge. Maybe it's just because I'm a bit fat. Never mind. Never mind. But if we're going to have faith, be full of faith, we've got to exercise it. So sometimes that faith needs to be, have a word added to it. What people sometimes say that faith is spelt R-I-S-K. Risk. We've just got to take a chance and say, you know, God, I don't feel very confident in this in my own ability, but you've called me to it, so I'm going to risk it. I'm going to do it. And you'll be amazed at what happens when you see God work through you and in you when you do something as a risk in faith, when you take a risk in faith. And that's how you start small. You don't say, oh, right, okay, I'm going to go and be a missionary to Outer Mongolia because that's the risk that I'm taking because I feel God's calling me. No, you don't start with the big things. You'll never get up there like a muscle. You've got to build it up. And how do they tell you to build muscles? They tell you start with small weights and do lots. So that's what you have to do. You have to take lots of little risks here and there. It might be as simple as saying, I'm going to go talk to that person over there who I've never spoken to, and I'm going to encourage them. So being joyful and an encourager, we go over and we take a risk to exercise our faith just a little bit, just to say, oh, you look nice today. I hope you have a great day. Jesus loves you. Or something like that. Just to talk to somebody you've never spoken to before. Take a risk and see what happens. You might have a really good conversation out of the tiny little risk that you've taken. And when you take one risk, you take another one and another one. Little risks lead up to big muscles in faith. And that's what we all need to do. And I preach this to myself. I need to do it more because when I do it more, it makes a difference. So if we're going to live up to our name, we need to be good. We need to be full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. So last slide. What is in a name? What's in a name? A great deal, I should think. If we're going to be called Christian, we've got to look like Jesus wherever we are in our character. And we can do it when we're joyful, when we're being encouraging, and when we're good, full of Holy Spirit and faith, developing our character into the likeness of Jesus. So I don't know where you're at today, but let's take a moment and just respond. What's the one thing that God is saying to us? And crucially, what's the little risk? What's the one thing I'm going to do to push myself forward in this and work with God to be more like Jesus? Take a moment and just in the quiet, ask Holy Spirit, I'll pray for us all. Come Holy Spirit, show us, Lord, the one thing we need to hear today and the one thing we need to do about it. Father, we thank you for your love and your mercy and your grace to us. We thank you, Lord, for your name, which is higher and greater and above all. And we thank you that we have the privilege of sharing in your life and sharing your name. Sharing indeed your title of Messiah, of Christ. And Lord, for all of us here today who call ourselves followers of Jesus, servants of Jesus, servants of the Christ, we say, Lord, help us to be more like you and live up to our name. Lord, where we need to be good, where we need to be full of the Spirit, where we need to be full of faith, Lord, come. Bless us, we pray. Help us to know that we're good not through our actions, but through all that Jesus has done for us. To be full of the Spirit because we ask and we expect. To be full of faith because we're learning to take little risks every day and build up our faith. To be from tiny to big, knowing that it's not about the size of our faith, but it's about the one in whom our faith rests, Jesus, the God of the impossible. Lord, where we're not joyful in our lives, Lord, come. We give to you our disappointment. We give to you anything that stops us from fully knowing that full joy of being completely held within the arms of God for eternity. Lord, come and reassure us of our hope. And so fill us with joy afresh today. And Lord, where we need to use our words to be encouraging, to strengthen and build up, to comfort, Lord, give us the words. Give us the heart. Lord, change our hearts so that we rest in the love of God for every person that we meet, so that our words will be encouraging. Father, we thank you for the example that we see in Barnabas. And we thank you, Lord, for our name. We pray, God, today we would live up to it. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. We're going to keep responding as we sing. Amazing. Do you want to share it or do you want me to share it? Go on then. Yeah. Ivor's got a testimony for us.
Very short. Yesterday morning I started with this terrific pain around here and in my eye. And it got so bad, I took some paracetamol, what you do. Still didn't go away, and I started to worry that it might be something leading to a loss of eyesight. So I went on to 111 and rang them, and they put me through to the eye clinic. And the eye clinic then said, yes, I explained the situation, we'll get you an appointment today. And anyway, what happened was I had a 3:30 appointment at Specsavers in Trowbridge, because they do the sort of any referrals like that. And I just wanted to make sure that the eyeball was all right, because I didn't want to lose sight. Anyway, the pain was still going on and throbbing and all, and feeling quite sore, and I've got a bit of a bloodshot eye at the moment. Anyway, during this morning service, I've been sat there and it's gone. I just wanted to share that with you, because obviously I've been sending up prayers, but I'm not concentrating on it, but it's gone this morning. I just wanted to share that with you. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord. That's what God does when we're in his presence. We're going to sing together. You can stand as you feel able. And we're just going to respond and ask the Lord to fill us afresh, to love people with open arms. And particularly draw your attention to the bridge. Let all my life tell of who you are, living up to our name and the wonder of your never-ending love. That God is wonderful. So, be filled with kindness and compassion for the one for whom you loved and gave your son for humanity. Increase my love, so help me to love with open arms like you do. A love that erases all the lines and sees the truth. Oh, that when they look in my eyes, they would see you, even in just a smile, they would feel the Father's homeless to the homeless and in between. You formed us, you made us carefully, 'cause in the end we're all your children. So help me to love with open arms like you do. I love that erases all the lines and sees the truth. Oh, that when they look in my eyes, they would see you, even in just a smile, they would feel the Father's love. Let all my life tell of who you are and the wonder of your name. Tell of who you are and the wonderful and such a good Father. Let all my life tell of who you are and the wonder of your never-ending love. Let all my life tell of who. A good Father, so help me to love with open arms like you do. A love that erases all the lines and sees the truth. Oh, that when they look in my eyes, they would see you, even in just a smile, they would feel.
Thank you, Lord. Yes, God. May all our lives tell of who you are. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father, for your healing power. And Lord, we pray that as we've talked about faith and Ivor's testimony has raised our faith levels, Lord, shed your healing power abroad in our midst this morning. If anyone needs healing, just raise a hand, open a hand towards God and say, yes, Lord, I receive it in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us in your death and resurrection, in your life. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, bless you, God. Thank you, Lord, that the name of Jesus is powerful. We bless you, God. Amen. Do please be seated. We're going to pray together, and Heather's going to come and lead us. Thank you.
I've based or used Psalm 46 to help me with the prayers today. So I've taken a response from Psalm 46. And if I say the Lord Almighty is with us, if you feel you want to say the words, the God of Jacob is our fortress, is the response that I've worked in. Thank you. So shall we pray? Thank you, Lord, for the stillness in which we can feel your presence. You tell us to be still. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Help us, Lord, to always remember that you are with us. Help us to be still, to wait patiently for you. Help us not to fret or worry, and help us always to hope in you. Lord, so much can shake our determination to wait on you. Lord God, we see around us the devastation man has caused in the neglect of your world. We are living in times of increasing disasters, floodings, wildfires, famines, wars, and earthquakes. Around the world, innocent people are caught up in the greed of the powerful and the complacency of the many. Psalm 46 tells us, God is a safe place to hide, ready to help when we need him. We stand fearless at the cliff edge of doom, courageous in the sea storm and earthquake, before the rush and roar of oceans, the tremors that shift mountains. God of angel armies protects us. We hold those words of the psalm in our hearts, Lord, as we lift the areas of the world to you where people are suffering and struggling to find safety. Greece has had both fires and flood. Hawaii, where they are still struggling with the effects of the fire. Canadian wildfires have affected all 13 provinces. The smoke is now impacting the health of the people in the USA. The earthquake in Morocco and flash floods in India, China, and Italy. We lift all of these areas to you and ask that you will sustain and help the people in these countries. And Lord, we also ask that you will direct the governments and rulers to want to work together for the good of all mankind. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. You are always near those who call out to you, Lord. We request that our hearts and ears be opened also to the needs of the people around us. We give thanks to you for the young people in our church, in our town and communities, and we bring them to you and ask that you will bless them. We especially think of the young people that come into our family here at West End, our members' children, the Sunday school, the toddlers group, the youth group. We pray that you will guide them, guard them, and direct us so that they may grow up safely and full of love. We pray for their families, so many pressures on a family now, Lord. We ask that you will lead them day by day and bring them close to you so they will know that they are not alone. We pray for the children's workers here and in the town and ask that you will empower them with love and care for your word so they will help the youngsters in their care, help them to develop their love for you and your ways. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. We have many among us who are unwell, and we ask that you will cover them with your healing grace and bring them into full health again. We especially think of Colin and Anne and the many others that we know who aren't well at the moment. We thank you for the care they have already received and ask that you continue to support them and their families. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. We thank you, Father God, for the diversity of your world. You made each and every one of us individuals that you love and cherish. Incredible God, there are many areas where man has made diversity in worship and thought a crime. And many are finding that following your Son Jesus and your way of truthful love and caring as you teach is frowned upon. The people in Pakistan live in such an area. Christian believers of that country have put together readings, prayers, and testimonies for worldwide worship in the form of the World Day of Prayer. They hope to inspire other women and people around the world to bear with one another in love during troubled times. For all these people, we prayfully ask that you will cover them with your grace and protection now and in the years to come. And we thank you, Lord, for each and every one of them, for their courage and their love for you. Be in every situation, Lord. Bring harmony, peace, and protect those who love you in all countries that face the same persecution of faith and freedoms. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Thank you, Father, that we can look to you in all situations. We ask you protect us from evil. Help us to look to you as our protector, the one who fights for us every day. You are the God of the angel armies. Surround us daily so we will not fear whenever, whatever might come against us. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Amen.
Good. We're going to close, sing our final song, unless Evan wants to show us what he's been doing. Do you want to show us what you've been doing? Come to the... You wouldn't think a couple of weeks ago he did a full-on presentation.
It's quite. Feeling shy.
What have you been up to? So it's an acrostic with bits for so things that talk that sort of are like a Christian, basically. Yeah. Oh, was it? I like a word search. I have to have that afterwards. Thanks, Evan. Good. Let's stand as we're able and sing our final song.
And then
mighty Savior, lifted high, King forever, Jesus Christ, crowned in glory, raised to life, the same power lives in us. Mighty Savior, lifted high, the power of his name. Death you overcame once and for all. The grave could not contain the power of his name. Death you overcame once and for all. Mighty Savior, lifted high, ourselves as we go, as we sing the blessing. So yeah, it is very much a kind of a, you have to sing to each other, but I appreciate if you don't know the words, you can't really look at each other. But we'll look at each other in spirit, shall we? Let nothing disturb thee, nothing affright thee. Well done for making it. There's tea. Well, I don't know if you'll want tea and coffee out the back. You might want something cold. But there's stuff out the back, so do join us for that.